Beauty that made this home. Amen. More than you can trust. No matter what's happening. If you're like the three Hebrews facing the fiery furnace, he can air condition it for you. You'll be the fourth man in there with you. You won't be in there alone. Remember back when Castro was doing the revolution for Cuba, and we had this preacher at our church. He had grew up with Castro, and Castro had him as his minister after they grew up. And when he was doing the revolution, he brought him on as the chaplain. But then after Castro went communist, he said, when Castro changed mine, I changed country. Castro brought him in and told him he was going to give him a chance to denounce Christ, or they were going to nail his feet to the floor. And he said, I'm not doing it. He said, I'm sticking with God. You might have changed. You changed because when we were growing up, you believed in God. But he said, I'm not changing. And they nailed his feet to the floor. And he said he didn't feel no pain. And he just got a hold of this and pulled him up. Walked out of there. He said, no harm. No, you know, lockjaw. No great gangrene, no nothing. He had no ill effects from it. Because God protected him. And he escaped from Castro and came to America. And you might not ever have to be faced with denying him or getting your feet nailed to the floor, but whatever your problem is, it's a big problem to you. But God is a big God. He's bigger than, as that song goes, bigger than all my problems, bigger than all my fears. God is bigger than any mountain. He's got it covered. He'll meet your needs, whether they're spiritual, physical, financial, or emotional, if we will. Call on him and trust him. You know, the Bible says that when you catch the thief, he has to repay sevenfold. But a lot of times we give up when we get just a little relief. You know, the devil's the thief. He comes and tries to steal our joy, tries to steal our health, tries to steal our finances, tries to steal everything we got. And kind of reminded me of Rod had a cocker spaniel named Cadis. And we built his pen right on the west side of my shop. And when I come out to work, well, he'd want out. Well, when I first started letting him out, he didn't want to go back in. So next time I wouldn't let him out. But he finally learned that if he would go in, he'd get out more. And he got where he would jump up on his doghouse and put one paw on the fence post in the L, and he would sit there and closer I got to the gate and I'd let it out, and he would run and play and do, you know, his thing. And he got even to the point that when he seen me putting up my tools, well, he would go get in and turning out the lights in the shop. He would just go put his shop back in he'd jump up on the dog pen and get back up there and wait for me to close the gate. Well, one night he was feeling real rambunctious. I was doing something, pulled my gloves off and laid them down. He came out and snatched them. And he took off running. I said, hey! Boy, he stopped and I said, what do you think you're doing? He stopped and looked at me. I said, bring your gloves back here. He dropped them right there. You know, I could have just, well, but I got on the ground. Now, I could have just, well, okay, that's good enough. But I didn't. I said, that's not where you got them. I said, pick them gloves up and bring them here. And he looked at me and kind of, you know, and I said, bring them gloves back. And he picked them up, put them back where he got them from. I said, okay, now go on. But a lot of times, you know, we'll holler at the devil and he'll stop. But the Bible says he has to repay. We give up before he repays. He'll drop the gloves, or he'll drop what he stole from us, and then we got to go get it back. But the Bible says we can make him bring it back through the Word and through Jesus. We just give up too quick. We got to hang in there. until the end. We got to hang in there until the battle's over, not just for the first charge. And but when it's all said and done, we win because we're on the winning side. Sermon number one. All right, we're going to receive our evening tithes and offerings. But don't give up on your miracle. Father, tonight we thank you that your word is true. And whatever that Satan is buffeting us with or taking away from us, Father, we say right now he has to bring it back. Bring it to a halt, Father, and make him restore those things he's taken. Father, tonight we thank you for this offering, and we ask that you bless and multiply back to us in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Good singing tonight. I love that Jesus, lover of my soul. That blesses me so every time we do it. It just such a feeling that comes over you. When you love on Jesus, he loves on you right back.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Now we're glad to have you that are in the stream tonight, or if you're going to join with us sometime or other throughout the week. We're glad you're here. We're glad that you are here tonight in this place. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
People are happy and people are blessed when they live out their dreams. Well, I think I'll say that again. If you're living out your dreams, it's a sense of such joy and happiness and blessing. I want to tell you tonight, though, I want to prompt you to get a dream that you cannot fulfill on your own. Don't let it be easy. Hello? Get one bigger than you are, then get lost in it, so that God is helping you enjoy it and bringing about great and mighty things through it. One of the big problems with unhappy people is that they've let go of their dreams. They've lost their dreams. They've lost their goals. And they lost their purpose. Then they don't feel like there's anything to live for. But now to approach a dream, a goal, or purpose, you need to respond to Proverbs 8:34. So I'm going to ask you to go to that scripture. Proverbs 8:34, and I'm going to read 35 and 36 also. And the first thing I want to talk to you about in living out your dreams is listening. It's really important to listen to God when you're living out your dreams and you're waiting on Him to tell you what's next. So Proverbs 8:34 out of the NIV, blessed is a man who listens to me. Isn't that what I said? Those who listen to the Lord, who listens to me, watching daily at my doors, waiting at my doorway. Wow. For those who find me, find life and receive favor from the Lord. That those who fail to find me, harm themselves. All who hate me, love death. Wow. It's been a lot of years ago, back in the late 60s, early 70s, we were visiting with some really good friends back in that day. Now she has already gone on to be with the Lord, but he's still around. And just great friends. And we were talking, and she kept telling one of her sons, she had, I'm remembering a couple of sons. Anyway, one of them, she was telling him to do something, and he wasn't responding at all. And I finally said, is he a little on the deaf side, you think? I didn't have a child at that time, so didn't know. And so she said, no, just watch this. And she said, she called his name and she said, you want some candy? And boy, here he was. He was up on his feet. He was dancing around and ready for some candy. It's called
selective
hearing. Yeah. So listen to God when he calls your name. Be there, listening for what he has to say to you. You may not hear an audible voice, and most people don't. Many people do not, but it's all right, because he's got the written word that we can read, and he can speak to our hearts. Don't have to be in an audible voice. It can be, but it doesn't have to be. And if we have a listening heart, so that we know what he is saying, not just when the candy comes. Amen. You remember that, don't you? Second thing is, how do you know you are listening to God? When you respond. That's the answer. When you respond. Once again, I'm going to read those scriptures again to you. Blessed is the man or woman who listens to me, watching daily at my doors, waiting at my doorway. For those who find me find life and receive favor from the Lord. But those who fail to find me harm themselves. All who hate me love death. Now listen, whenever he speaks to our heart, if we start to respond, what did you do when you were growing up and mom, dad said, I want you to sweep the floor. I want you to go to the grocery store for me. I want you to take out the trash. What did you do? Did you just sit there? No, we didn't dare. Remember? We didn't dare. Amen. We respond. And when we respond and not wait 30 minutes to respond, sometimes we're just trying to get it in our heads, huh, that is this really God? You'll get a feeling that this is the Lord speaking to your heart. You'll begin to get a feeling, oh, this is the Lord talking to my heart. And you begin to feel that comfort of the Holy Spirit, and things begin, and you begin to respond to Him like maybe He's saying, get the Word, open the book, search out the Scriptures. Maybe He's saying, pray. There's someone in your neighborhood that needs prayer. Pray for them. And we begin to respond. So we listen and we respond to Him. And the more we respond, the more He blesses us. But once we get hold of how to hear the Lord, then we begin to respond to that. Then it begins to be wonderful. Third thing. So I'll go through these pretty quickly. Third thing comes right out of that first scripture, that 34th verse. Come early and wait on the Lord. That's what this is about. Come early and wait on the Lord. It seems to point out, according to a lot of commentators, that the hungriest of the students around had an intense desire to learn. Even before the gates were open to where they would go and study the Word, that in the classes, they would come early and they would wait there for admission to get to go in. Reminds me of being in Australia and our last tour into Australia. I think we went into Australia three times in the 80s. And the last time that we went in, I remember going out into the Aboriginal village, and that's where we were going to have a great revival. And we did have a great revival. And there were people, as we drove in, and we had a big van that held several people because we were all coming to have service and to set up with instruments and various things. And anyway, some of the people began to run out to the van and began to praise God and thank the Lord for revival coming. And they said, well, when's it going to be? When's it going to be? And this one woman asked, well, when's it going to be? And we told her, well, 7 o'clock tonight or whatever time it was going to be that night. She said, and it was 10 in the morning, and she said, I'm going to go home right now and start getting ready for that service. That's what I'm talking about, is come early and wait on the Lord. Remember, as a young person, with the call of God on my life, and we young people were hungry and thirsty for the things of God, and we would come early, and we would go into the prayer room before service ever started, and we'd begin to pray and seek the Lord for a mighty service. And, you know, there were many times that, and the door to the prayer rooms was on stage, and we would come out shouting and praising God because heaven came down in that prayer room. Praise God. And it still will. It still will. Come early and wait for His presence. Get an excitement inside of you. This is the things of God. You know, I still feel that way. I'm always excited. We get here about an hour before every service. I'm always excited to be in the house of God and be with the people and be with God. Amen. And He said, blessed are those people that do this. That just, now, I'm not saying anything about what time you're coming to service. It's about preparing your heart. Be prepared in your heart for the things of God. You can do that anywhere because you got an audience with Him anywhere you are. You could be praying about service all day long, getting ready, and even on your job, can't you? And just have that prayerful thing going in your heart. And by the time you get to church, you're ready. Woo, something good is about to happen. Hallelujah. Now, the fourth thing I want to say, now this is in seeing and living out your dream. Need some excitement about what God, who God is, and what He will do when we get to the house of God together. Because If he's mighty, and he is in our personal lives, you multiply that by however many other people are in the audience that have that same desire and same hunger, and they begin to worship God, and things begin to happen. You're blessed, he said. You have a blessed life when you have that come to God and stay. Wait in his presence. Fourth thing is obedience is everything to God. Did you know that? With God, and if you read the scripture, you find out that he loves obedience in our lives. Psalms 27 and 8, my heart says of you, seek his face. I mean, it's like you're saying to yourself, ooh, my heart is telling me, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I will seek. Is that how you feel? Get hungry. Get hungry for the things of God. I think we have to get hungry and stay hungry to see more happen. John 7, 16 through 18, Jesus answered, my teaching is not my own. What I'm teaching you, it's not my own. It comes from the one who sent me. By the way, you know Jesus is the Word made flesh and dwelt among us. And he said, anyone who chooses to do the will of God will find out. They will know whether my teaching comes from God or whether I speak on my own, and whoever speaks on their own does so to gain personal glory. But he who seeks the glory of the one who sent him is a man of truth. There is nothing false about him. It's wonderful. We're at my Aunt Mary's celebration of her going home yesterday. Sort of felt like that at times, and then the loss was real big for so many of the family. And yet, as I listened to the minister in the eulogy, as he talked, and the very fact that this preacher was their pastor, my aunt's pastor and my uncle's pastor before he passed away a couple of years ago. Anyway, he was part of the kids growing up. He hung around with the kids. He said he ate there more than he ate at home. So he knew the family, didn't he?
Wow.
He knew what they were about. He had something to say about that because he knew. He said, I was there, I hung around. And he said, they've got to call me a preach. I'm happy to say that my aunt and uncle were ready to meet them. Hallelujah. So that is, obedience is everything. Now this young man, I guess he's not so young, but he was young to me, that preached this, had so many good things to say because he had been there. Do you know, when you been there, when you've been with the Lord through the day, you've got something precious in your life. You got something to share, and when you meet someone that is just needing something, you got something to give them. If someone needs a drink of spiritual water, you don't have to run to the fountain. You already got it inside. And you can share it because you've been with him. Fifth thing I want to talk about is what the Lord wants to know is, are you a willing person? If so, he can teach you anything. People say, well, what if God, he touches my life and he wants me to do this or this or this, but what if he looks back at things in my past? And I said many times over and over to many people, that's past, that's under the blood. You just keep it under the blood. What the Lord wants to know this is, are you willing? You know, we only had one child. I guess it was hard on him because anything I wanted done extra, I had to call on the one kid. If you have four, you got three more to call on. You're down to one again. No, really, you added six more. Counted up, no. Five. Counted up. Yeah, there you go. What the Lord wants to know is, are you willing, person? Are you willing? And that's always touched me and always blessed me when Rod would get up from what he's doing. He may not have wanted to, but he'd get up from what he's doing and he would take out the trash or do something else that I needed done. Isaiah 1 and 19 says, if you are willing and obedient, you'll eat the good of the land. If you with your whole heart are willing and fully resolved to obey all that he asks of you, not only will he pardon all of your sins, you will receive a lot of blessings on top of that. Lewis and I were called into the ministry. I was called at a young age, and he must have been too, because he prayed and asked God to give me to him. That we would marry, and it's on you now. Are y'all here? Yeah. Are we willing to do that? I know God created that union, because not many would follow a woman in ministry, and he has. In fact, I think he's a better preacher than I am. He doesn't want to admit it, but I think he is. He's just waiting for that moment in every service when he's supposed to give what God gives him. And boy, didn't he do it tonight. Now, I'm not just lifting him up. I'm telling you, when God puts something in your heart, if you're willing, it will come pouring out like it did through him tonight. And it was powerful. It was a good message. Sixth thing, when you hear him, you follow. When you hear him, as you're listening and you begin to respond, you follow him. My sheep hear my voice, and a stranger they won't follow. That's out of John 10, 27 and verse 5. My sheep hear my voice. They're not going to follow a stranger because they're hearing my voice, he said. False doctrines aren't going to get to you and in you because you're in tune to his voice. And that's another reason why we need to listen for his voice real closely, so that we're not caught up in false doctrines. God has grace for babies, though, I want to add. The immature in the Lord, he places them in families. He puts them in churches and places where there's people that can help and grow them up and mature them, because baby sheep will follow the adult sheep. Hello? Baby lambs will follow the adult sheep because they don't know anything yet until they see it as they're following. A lot of times there's people that come in and the Lord allows us to lead you. You and you, to lead someone else. Help them to become mature. And it's really important to mature in the Lord. But God has grace for babies. He knows they're immature. Hello. But if they've been 50 years trying to grow up, I think something needs to be done there. Hello. Do you know what I mean? Troublemakers in a church that, you know, we don't have any of those. Troublemakers that create all kinds of chaos because they're 50 years old and still haven't grown up. But God still graces and says, come on, you can do this. Come on, you can do this. So don't give up on yourself. Don't give up on your own ability to get there. And don't look back at your past, because he doesn't. Why should we if he doesn't? Hello? My sheep know my voice. Listen for it. You'll hear that inner visit on the inside of you, and you'll begin to get a peace about something you've been asking him about. Don't do anything if you don't have peace about it. But that peace will settle in. You get talking to the Lord about something, and is this your real Lord? What should I do here? What do I do there? And you begin to get a peace about it, and then you know you've got an answer. So don't give up on yourself. God uses babies, and God uses adults. Just the babies will grow as they go. I'm going to drop the scriptures about Samuel when he was just a lad. The prophet Samuel was called as a child to do the will of God. He guided the nation 40 years. He was God's voice in the land for 40 years. But it took time for him to learn to know God's voice. He didn't know it immediately. So don't feel bad at yourself if you don't know it immediately. Hello? So 1 Samuel 3, we find that the boy Samuel ministered to the Lord. And remember, his mother brought him to the house of the Lord, but she didn't forget him. She brought him a new coat every year. She kept him going. And the boy Samuel ministered to the Lord before Eli. And the word of the Lord was rare and precious in those days. There was no widespread revelation, and there was a great need for the word of the Lord in the land. And Samuel said yes. But he didn't know the voice of the Lord right at first. So don't feel bad at yourself if you don't at first, but you'll learn it. And it came to pass at that time while Eli was lying down in his place, and when his eyes had begun to grow so dim that he could not see, and before the lamp of God went out in the tabernacle of the Lord, where the ark of God was, and while Samuel was lying down, that the Lord called Samuel. And he answered, "Here I am." And he jumped up and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." And Eli said, "No, I didn't call you." So he went and he lay down again, and the Lord called yet again, "Samuel." So Samuel arose and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." And he answered, "I did not call you, my son, lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, nor was the word of the Lord yet revealed to him. He had to learn that. But he had to call on his life. And the Lord called Samuel again the third time. So he arose and he went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you did call me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord had called the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go and lie down, and it shall be, if he calls you, that you must say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant hears.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood and called as at other times, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel answered, "Speak, for your servant hears." God gave Samuel a prophecy, a word of the future that night. When Samuel finally realized this was the Lord calling, but he was directed by Eli, the priest. And so Samuel got this word from the Lord, and it was all about Eli and his sons who were bad in the house of the Lord. There was iniquity in Eli's house. Verse 14, "And therefore I have sworn to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be atoned for by sacrifice or offerings forever." Eli allowed his sons to have unrestrained evil in and against God's house. And that was a sad thing. And God was finished with that evil. And so, Samuel, here is this young person that goes, "If I tell Samuel, I'm going to hurt his feelings. What's he going to do to me? Is he going to kick me out?" But he didn't want to hurt the heart of God. And so, when he told Eli everything, because Eli asked, he said, "Now I want you to tell me, what did the Lord say to you?" And Eli said, "It is the Lord, let him do what seems good to him." So Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him. And all Israel from Dan to Beersheba knew that Samuel had been established as a prophet of the Lord. Then the Lord appeared again in Shiloh, for the Lord revealed himself to Samuel in Shiloh by the word of the Lord. No matter what is happening around you, you can experience peace in your heart when he speaks. And when you get peace in your heart, you know that God's spoken. If you hear something that you're not sure about, wait until you have peace. Samuel started young and continued into old age to do God's will. We can. I was called at a very young age. I was probably no more than 8 or 9 when I first had my indication that something was pulling at my heart. And it took me several years into my early teens to know for sure that was God calling. But I had visions. And I felt the pull of the Holy Spirit, and I knew he was talking to me. And I started young. As my pastor put me in the pulpit. Oh, in fact, he put me on the radio, and I'm going, what is going on here? So I was on the radio preaching, testifying, when I was a young teenager, probably 14, 15, I don't know. But did you know that Joan of Arc, have you heard that name? Joan of Arc turned a war around when she was 17 because she had a calling in her life. Pascal developed a calculator at the age of 17. Well, if you don't say I am but a child, because he could use children. Mozart wrote his first symphony when he was 8 years old. Isn't that amazing? Don't say I'm too young. Don't say I'm too old. Walton opened his first true Walmart in 1962 when he was 44 years old. You say, well, that's not old. No, it's not young either. It's amazing what he has done with Walmarts. Amen? Colonel Sanders was 70 when he developed the Kentucky Fried Chicken. And everyone knows about Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Even in Australia.
I remember in Mexico, Kentucky Fried Chicken. That's what they wanted to go get us. Let's go get some Kentucky Fried Chicken. And it was amazing. Colonel Sanders at 70 developed that Kentucky Fried Chicken, and he gave much of his profits to nonprofit work of the Lord. John Wesley was traveling on horseback. John Wesley, the preacher, you remember. He was preaching on traveling on horseback at age 88. Hello, I got a ways to go. When he turned 90, think about this. When John Wesley turned 90, he complained that he could preach only twice a day. And he had an inclination to sleep all the way to 5 a.m. in the morning. Hello. Tells me something. If God calls you, if God says this is the thing I want you to do, then you may as well roll your sleeves up and go, yes, Lord, and give him all. Paul says, and the life that life is worth nothing unless I use it for doing the work assigned me by the Lord Jesus, Acts 20 and 24. Luke 9 and 24, and I'm almost finished. Luke 9 and 24, for whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me will save it. Somebody say, speak, Lord, for your servant hears. I'm willing, Lord. You know my heart. I never wanted to step out in my own thing. Always had to know it was you. Speak, Lord, for your servant hears. So whatever age we are, young or old, aged, Some people say you're aging well. Well, I don't know exactly what that means. Somebody, one of my cousins said yesterday when I told him, I should stop telling him how old I am. When I told him how old I was, he goes, you don't look it. Age well in the Lord. Do God's will. Do His plan. I never thought in my life that from a little girl that was so bashful she couldn't give an oral book report in front of a class without forgetting it all. Loved reading, though, but couldn't give that report in front of people. And He calls me to preach. He'll qualify and help you for anything He calls you for. He'll set you into it. It's powerful. He'll do in you what you let Him do. So He called you to sing. So He called you to play. So He called you to preach. So He called you to teach. So He called you to testify. So He called you to help each other. So He called you to invite people. So He called you to be a witness. So hello, whatever He calls you to. What does He call us to? Apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher. And then there's all those other giftings. He'll qualify you. He will. Where there's work to be done, there's a place for you. And I never thought that He would send us around the world. Who would have thought it? I was a little girl that couldn't give a book report. And He sent us around the world to preach the gospel. But I just said, then I give it all up and say, yes, Lord, and You're going to have to take the reins. And when He takes the reins, anything can happen. Are you here? You say, well, I'm too young, or well, I'm too old. Well, I think tonight should wipe that out of your thoughts. You're not too young and you're not too old. I can do anything. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I am a promise. I'm a possibility, the song says. I can do whatever He appoints me to do. But if He doesn't appoint me, I can't do it. You hear? Because that would be me out by myself. But with Him, Christ in me is my hope of glory. Christ pulls me, draws me on with Him. Say, come on. We still have work to do. How about you? We still have a job to do. We still have work to do. Oh, I was doing this back when I held a full-time job. Hello? And I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Still can. And you can too. Here I am, Lord. I want to hear you. Speak, for Your servant hears you. Speak to my heart. I hear you. My heart is open to you. Lead me and I will follow. Lead me and I'll go wherever You want me to go. I'll say whatever You want me to say. I used to say that, pray that all the time. I'll go where You want me to go, dear Lord. I'll say what You want me to say. I'm not sure back then I knew what I was saying. Because when it dawned on me, I was going to have to get up in front of those people. That was hard. But it did, because I knew He called me. And when you know that, you know that, you know that He called you, you can do all things through Christ, which strengthens you. Father, we come to You now. We praise You. because your presence is in this place, because you have given the word. Great is the word that's being carried forth. Father, I pray that this word goes forth because we're in an hour. It's late. You're calling people to do your will. It's time to stand up and be counted. It's time to preach the word. It's time to speak the word to our friends and our neighbors. We must stand for something so we don't fall for anything. So here we are, Lord, in your presence, lifting holy hands to you. Here we are, Lord, and we say, yes. Speak, Lord, for your servant hears you. Father, I pray over every single person out there that they just say yes. Whatever I can do, I want to do. Whatever I can do, I want to do. In Jesus' name. Let him call you. Let him touch you. Let him. Just tell him back. I want to hear you, Lord. I want to hear you. I want to hear your voice in my heart, in my spirit, man. And I say yes right now. I say yes. I'll say yes. Yes, yes. I'll say yes. Stream tonight. God bless you for coming by. God bless you. May the Lord bless you.